From the campus of Minneapolis South High School in the south side of the city, as the name would suggest, we proudly present another edition of High School Girls Basketball. Tonight, the Minneapolis South Tigers host the number one team in Class 3A, the Orono Spartans, a state semifinalist in last year's 3A state tournament bracket. Greetings, everyone. I'm Mike Peden, and I'm joined by Alex Nagel, who is finally making his debut. Even though he may have lost some wisdom teeth, his wisdom is still highly intact. Alex, Orono, one of the favorites to win 3A this year, now that Park Center is classed up, and a lot of that has to do with their returning players, including Meghan Mandel and Tori Andrew.
You know, I tell you, when I got to watch Orono play a couple times last year, Mike, I was so impressed with that team. And you're right, 6'4 senior Meghan Mandel really is the heart and soul of this team, and she's poised to do big things this year.
Well, she'll continue doing big things next year. She has committed to Marquette, got a double-double in Orono's season-opening win over Wayzata, and that's one thing that Orono is doing to prepare themselves this year. Now that they got to state, Ellen Wiese scheduled a lot of 4A teams to get Orono ready to make another run.
Well, I think that's important, Mike, you know, especially for a team as talented as Orono is. You play these tough teams early on, it can really pay dividends come January, February, and March.
Minneapolis South going through some reorganizing. Tanisha Scott left to take the De La Salle job. We've already covered them a couple of times. Nathan McGuire took over, and he's running more of a man-to-man system, but the biggest obstacle facing the Tigers right now, they only had 8 practices from his hiring before the start of the season. And this is their second number one team in the first 4 games of the year. They already played number one Hopkins to open the season.
Well, I tell you what, Mike, if you want to get battle tested early on, there's no better way to do it than this way. You know, obviously, there's some big obstacles for South tonight. I think the key for them, you know, being that Meghan Mandel is such a great player, if they can find a way to neutralize her, they won't completely stop her, but if they can force her to do things that she doesn't like to do, it could have an effect here tonight.
Boxing out will be vital to the outcome of this game, but Minneapolis South is no pushover, and that has to do with a couple of sisters whose last name is Hill. Of course, that name's synonymous here. Morgan Hill, a sophomore, and Jade Hill, who was reluctant to come in as a 7th grader, but relented, and both of them are having a great start to the season for the Tigers.
Well, you can expect those two will be doing some great things here at Minneapolis South, Mike, and what a better way to showcase their talent and skills than going up against an elite opponent tonight in Orono.
And they feel it can help them prepare themselves for a potential Minneapolis City Conference title, but we'll talk more about that as the game goes along. The tip-off and starting lineups are coming up in a moment. This is High School Girls Basketball. Welcome back to Minneapolis South High School. Let's take a look at the starting five for both teams. For the visiting Orono Spartans, it's number 12, Lily McCown, the 5'6 senior guard. Number 21, Danielle Jorgensen, the 5'8 senior guard. Number 23, Tori Andrew, 5'10 junior guard. Number 40, Hannah Strigau, 5'10 senior forward. And number 44, Meghan Mandel, the 6'4 senior center. She could be among the list of athletes who threatens the blocks race this season in the State High School League. Minneapolis South will start number 11, Adria Stewart, the 5'2 senior guard. Number 15, Rose Lutz, the 5'11 junior forward. Number 20, Jade Hill, the 5'5 seventh grade guard. Number 23, Michaela Lemieux, the 5'3 senior guard. And number 24, Morgan Hill, the 5'9 sophomore guard. And I mentioned Mandel as a potential leader in the state blocks race this season because in the season opening win against Wayzata, Mandel had 5 of them. And at 6'4", I've got a feeling a lot of blocks could be coming her way.
Oh, no question about it, Mike. She's got the ability to do just that. And I would be very surprised if she isn't the finalist for that when it's all said and done. You know, the big thing for me when I watch Orono tonight is, you know, replacing the big role that Kiara Nelson had for this team last year. Nelson, of course, the point guard last year, who anchored that spot for the last few years for the Spartans, now up at UM Duluth. You know, I just want to see how Orono adjusts without her being there, and I think that's going to be interesting to watch.
Well, in the case of Kiara Nelson, as you mentioned, I guess a replacement. I don't know if we can replace her, but the person who took over was Danielle Jorgensen, and Ellen Wiese has had nothing but high praise for her. Jorgensen had four steals in the win over Wyzetta, and she expects Jorgensen to be one of the best defenders in the state this season. And overall, even though they got upset by Marshall, getting to state last year was the culmination of this building project that began 4 years ago when, now 5 years ago, when they won just three games. Last year, they were 30-2. Their only two losses were to Minnetonka and Marshall, and Wiese had said that loss to Marshall was just the result of one bad half, the only time they really had a bad half all year, and experience as well. The Marshall Tigers have been to state for a long time. The Spartans made their first appearance in school history, and they have the ball to start this game. They wear the white, South wears the black. In a gym that has produced many memories, at least in my prep coverage, as I continue my 10th season. I'll never forget the first time I was here, 2007, Minneapolis South, St. Paul Central, Twin Cities game. This place was sold out to the brim. Our first field goal attempt is off the mark from number 12. That's Olivia McCown. The baseline jumper is off. And South will run. Now, Adria Stewart will fire the three and is short. South is going to run what Nathan McGuire calls a gimmick defense to try to contain Mandel because South doesn't have the height to stop her. And Lily McCown gets the baseline J from the right side to get our first basket of the game.
Well, obviously, I think the key for South here, particularly in this early going, Mike, is to somehow get Orono out of their comfort zone.
Well, they got Jade Hill out of their comfort zone, and Nathan McGuire will take an early timeout. So to continue on Orono's path, as you know, they want, of course, get to state again, and with Park Center classing up, I think just about any team in the 3A field has a pretty good chance, and Orono figures to be one of them because now they've gotten to state. They know what it's like. They were the number one seed last year, but more importantly, they have that experience, so it's not going to be as astonishing to them as it was a year ago.
Right.
And simply put, in the words of Ellen Wiese, getting to state made them excited to get back. And who wouldn't want to get back? South knows a few things about that. Adria Stewart can't bank the triple. And the rebound goes to McCown. To Jorgensen. Jorgensen, the point guard, so she's going to be more of the facilitator rather than the scorer. Orono got things started with a 57-55 win over Wyzetta on Tuesday, and what BC called a true first game, and every team pretty much has that, as Andrew misses the long-range deuce. But Mandel with the O board, and Andrew with the finish. Andrew Jr. already getting some looks from Ivy League schools. Jade Hill bounces to her older sister. And Morgan drives to the rim. And that's something that Taylor Hill didn't have when she was playing here. Yeah. You've got a couple of sisters who will be playing with each other, and that's a traveling violation on McCown. She took a bunny hop before releasing.
You talk about memories here, Mike. I was here with you back in 2012 when Eden Prairie came here. Of course, that Eden Prairie team was led by both Jackie Johnson and Shane Mullaney.
Mullaney in her senior season with the Gophers. Jackie Johnson transferred to a D2 school. Jade Hill is blocked by Meghan Mandel. Here come the Spartans. And a three on the way is short from Jorgensen. Mandel with the rebound and the putback. And I've got a feeling we'll be saying that phrase a few times throughout the season.
Obviously. Rose Lutz with the unenviable task of guarding Mandel here.
I think just about any 3A team will have an unenviable task. But Adria Stewart gets the runner, and it's 6-4 in favor of the Spartans. McCown pulls up. Not that time. But look who's there. It's Meghan Mandel. I think she's got three rebounds, a block, and 4 points.
Plain and simple, Mike, South has got to find a way to box her out.
Lemieux for three. Got it. Michaela Lemieux, considered a hustle player by Nathan McGuire. Entry pass, too high. Tipped and ultimately goes to Rose Lutz. Adria Stewart on the drive, and she'll draw the foul. I believe it will go against Andrew. Yes. Shooting foul, so Adria Stewart will shoot a pair. Adria Stewart averaging 10.6 points in the first three games of the season.
One more, release.
McGuire says they'll be leaning on her to help win a Minneapolis City Conference title, and it's actually 10.3 points, not 10.6, but who's counting? Stewart gets the back end. And we're tied at 8-all, and I'll finish up the South discussion in a moment. That's a three-pointer, and Jorgensen, or I should say Andrew, is pure.
Left her all alone from the right wing, Mike.
And Andrew is a good three-point shooter, as we've seen over the years. Lemieux. Whoa, that was dangerous.
Very dangerous.
Jade Hill kicks out to Morgan. And Morgan with a floater.
Nice move and finish by Morgan on that one, right in the lane.
Morgan led the Minneapolis City Conference in scoring last year. Bullseye, that's Danielle Jorgensen for real this time.
Boy,
and she gets on the board.
They don't get much prettier than that, right through the center of the net.
Orono with a four-point lead. They bring out pressure. They go inside, and Hill will fire for three. Jade Hill's too strong. Jorgensen, that's Andrew. I'm going to get those two right eventually. And a traveling violation on Tori Andrew. Now keep in mind, this is just the second game of the season for the Spartans. For Minneapolis South, this is their fourth. So Orono may still be getting the proverbial legs under them.
Yeah.
And for most teams, as you're aware, unless you're Hopkins or some of those super teams, it takes a few games to really adapt to a new style. And in the case of South, they're still working on it, as we've got a foul inside. Nathan McGuire working to convert this team to a man defense compared to the matchup zone that Tanisha Scott used to run.
Well, and you know, for Orono, you know, they won't see a style like this very often this year, so it's good that they get this kind of exposure early on, right?
Lemieux in traffic, no, and Morgan Hill used her body to draw the foul on Striga. That's going to be her second, and we're going to have a quick sub, as Morgan Hill will prepare to shoot two.
Positive vibes here for the Tigers early on, Mike. Being aggressive, getting into the lane, drawing fouls, and getting to the free throw line.
They're having some trouble converting them early, though. But Nathan McGuire, he understands that South is in a tough section, and tough primarily because Hopkins is in it.
Yeah.
Hopkins really benefited from the reclassification this year. Section 6, mostly Minneapolis schools now. So McGuire, he said, right now, our goal is just to win the city conference. And they were within a game of doing so last year. They split with Washburn, but also had a loss to North that cost them. And Rachel Rudd not taking long to make her presence known. Rudd was also on the soccer team that won state in 2014 and finished second this year in Class A. Morgan Hill inside, and she's hacked. And Meghan Mandel was there. I'm not sure Jorgensen saw her. If she did, maybe she backs off and Mandel gets another block. But again, we're up here and I'm just speculating.
It does go on Jorgensen, her first.
And that's the fourth team foul on Orono.
One more.
Morgan used to wear number 4 in honor of her big sister Taylor, and then switched to 24 in honor of Kobe Bryant. And then, since he's retiring, I wonder what she'll do next year.
Good question.
Taylor Hill calls Morgan Hill the boss lady. I don't know the origin of that nickname. I just know she's called boss lady. And I suppose when your WNBA bound sibling gives you a nickname, you take it. Orono can't get the entry passing cleanly, and they turn it over. But they do have a five-point lead over the Tigers. Lemieux to Lutz. Back to Stewart. Minneapolis South, not a deep team right now, so you're going to see maybe six or seven players. Adria Stewart can't hit the three-pointer, and Mandel beats Lutz to the rebound there. Jorgensen on the drive, rims out, Rudd with the rebound, and she loses it to Stewart. Cushing travels. And Mandel's going to take a breather. Now, Mandel last year was battling some illnesses. As I understand it, it was influenza. But in any case, that really hampered her production in the first third of the season. Now she's healthy and, in the words of Ellen Wiese, can put up a double-double every night now. And being healthy is a huge benefit.
Oh, absolutely.
Going up, but coming up short is number 12, McCown. Another battle for the rebound. It will stay with Orono. A lot of multi-sport athletes on this team. Four members of the varsity roster were on this season's girls soccer team that finished second. And Orono, over the years, has become a well-known representative in athletics. The boys' soccer team won state this year, and the girls have a first and second place finish in the last 2 years. This team finished third in the 3A bracket. They turn it over, though. And I recall back in that three-win season, I believe, they played Richfield and just got dominated. And now they're the ones dominating other opponents.
Yeah.
11 minutes to go in the first half. Stewart pump fakes the three, sees a lane, has to get rid of it. And may have been a bit premature. Orono with numbers. Jorgensen behind the back dish, and South deflects it. It will stay with the Spartans.
Bit of a missed opportunity there for the Spartans. Had a two-on-one going, and they couldn't quite finish, but they do get the ball back.
Madeline Loader will go in. And you also see number 33, Natalie Smarin.
Michaela Lemieux back in for the Tigers as well.
Who got that last basket?
I want to say it was Rachel Rudd, but I'm not sure.
We'll give it to Rudd, and I'll confirm it at halftime. Jump ball, and the arrow favors South. The defense there by Rachel Rudd. Rudd plans to go to Viterbo next year to play soccer.
Located right in La Crosse, Wisconsin.
Lutz had a good position, couldn't handle it though.
Those are the kind of opportunities that South has to finish on, Mike.
Jorgensen. To Loader. Now McCown will reset. Jorgensen can't get by Lemieux. And trying to save it was Smarin, but she stepped on the line. How about Lemieux? All 5'3" of her,
yeah.
And she stops her defender in her tracks.
That was good post up by Jorgensen as well.
Jade Hill cuts to the lane and comes up empty, and Orono can't handle it. And we see not afraid to use her depth early as Abigail Paris goes in. Nine players have already seen floor time for the Spartans. Jorgensen comes up with it. Rudd out to Jorgensen, thought about the three, goes for the two instead and gets the high bank.
Beautiful shot by Jorgensen on that. Just kissed that off perfectly in that drive right into the lane.
Orono builds their lead to nine. Adria Stewart South has come up empty in a lot of those drives.
Yep.
And Rachel Rudd with a miscue. Her pass to Paris, too low.
It's those simple mistakes that I suppose that you can expect here early on in the season.
And that's something that will clean itself up in time.
Yeah, yep.
But Orono has a bunch of hungry players in the words of Ellen Weese, and that hasn't gone away. Cushing, pure from the top of the key. That's your first field goal, and South cuts the deficit to 6. 21-15.
The freshman coming up big for the Tigers there, and they needed that one badly.
But Rudd can shoot threes as well. Not that time, and Jorgensen tried to save it, but as you know, if you touch the baseline before reaching the ball, you are considered out of bounds,
yep.
And that was the case with Jorgensen. So a dead ball rebound to the Tigers. We have 8:40 left in the first half. Lemieux to Cushing. And a jump ball, Orono with the arrow this time, and Mandel's gonna sub back in. Now I'm just curious, we have a long way to go before we think about state contenders, but what do you make of the 3A field? Because it looked like it was Park Center's group to do as they please, and then they get moved to 4A,
right.
So now they've got to face Hopkins. And so now all these other teams, as Mandel is fouled, will shoot two. All these other teams can find themselves hoisting the trophy.
Oh, absolutely, no question about it, Mike. Obviously, Orono is going to be in the discussion, as I think you would have to consider Como as a potential player in the whole scheme of things as well.
Mandel's first trip to the free throw line brings height, experience, and a double-double, as we noted before. And don't count out Marshall.
No. They lost some experience with this last year's group of graduating seniors, but they still have a lot coming back.
Lemieux hits the triple. That's your second. Mandel made both free throws, by the way, and we have a five-point game, 23-18. And it's always tough to check out Marshall because they're in the southwest corner of the state, but they always bring solid teams to the mix.
They sure do.
Paris up and traveled. That was actually Smarin. Paris will sub out and McCown will go back in. Another team to keep an eye on in 3A, New Prague.
Yep.
And they had a strong start in the opening weekend event at Hamlin. Morgan Hill, that was tipped. So it will stay with South with 7:25 to go. I've got a feeling we're going to need about a month or so for the field to sort itself out before we can figure out which teams have a good chance of taking the 3A trophy. Ooh, Jorgensen nearly intercepted the inbound pass. Adrian Stewart fires a three, can't hit it. Morgan Hill can't get to the ball in time. Nathan McGuire will call timeout with 7:19 left, and that's something that he'll have to use as Orono just has a deeper roster than South does right now. And as we noted in the open, McGuire came in late, was hired after the summer workout session. So the Tigers had just 8 practices to figure out this new system before they start the season against Hopkins, which is not an easy task in any class.
Well, and you know, McGuire has time to really, you know, before he has to start worrying about the refined product coming out in late December and January.
And something.
I was just going to say, so far, a good job by Minneapolis South, though, still in the thick of things, trailing by only 5 here with 7:19 left.
And one thing they're going to have to contend with throughout the season, just having a short lineup, so that's going to put an emphasis on boxing out, positioning for rebounds, because they're just not going to have the height to match up with some of these bigger teams in 4A. Still working on half-court sets, and when you make a conversion project like this, and this happens anytime you make a coaching change, patience is the biggest key.
Absolutely.
And it's not just the coaching staff that went through changes. South had a new athletic director in Brett McNeil this year. Mark Sanders, the longtime AD, left in the middle of last season. And McNeil came over from Edison. And he already is enjoying this position. He says he's very busy over here. And Smarin pretty busy herself. She gets her first field goal of the game out of the timeout. Morgan Hill will reset, goes to Stewart, over to Lemieux.
South showing some good patience here, Mike.
There's no shot clock, so you can be as patient as you like. As we noted, South started the year with Hopkins and Osseo, both lopsided losses, and then had a pretty convincing win against Richfield. Now, the Richfield team they faced is a bit weaker this year without the Adams sisters, but still, to get your first win is a big step in establishing confidence. And Daniel Jorgensen, the steal, the run out, and the finish.
Well, Les wanted to kick it out to the back court, Mike.
And Jorgensen
was
the pass.
Right there.
Hill runs into a wall, can't get the bounce. Megan Mandel was there, and Jorgensen was also in on the stop. Mandel to Smarin. McCown can't hit the elbow J. Morgan Hill with the rebound. Goes to Lemieux. Hesitates. Back to Morgan. On the line. Switch. Morgan Hill was pretty shy last year, at least when I spoke with her. I did a couple of South games and a feature on the Prep Spotlight show, but she's being more confident this year. And who else is confident? Madeline Loader.
And she really uncorked one there from the left top area.
Orono very confident from three-point range. With 5 minutes to go, they have a 10-point lead, 30-20. Lemieux used up the dribble. And walks. McCown out to Rudd. Rudd spins by Morgan. South didn't fall for it though. But here comes Jorgensen on the drive. And the runner's short. Smarin will draw the foul. It's the second charge to South.
The one thing that stands out for me right now when I look at this Orono team is how well Danielle Jorgensen is running the offense.
Well, she has plenty of experience going back to last year. She's got 7 points already. Had just five in the game against Wayzata, but Weese said Jorgensen will have her moments, even if scoring is not her primary duty. Morgan Hill, bullseye. The South staff still calls me through that term. I used it a lot in my early days of broadcasting. Here's McCown to Loader. Now McCown has it on the right wing. They're trying to feed Loader as they go to the high post. Now Rudd has a lane on the baseline and is too strong. Follows her own miss and cleans up her own mess.
Beautiful drive along the baseline by Rudd on that to get her in position.
Rudd with 7 points. Morgan to Lemieux. South trailing by nine, 32-23. Lemieux forced it, and Rudd with the rebound. And Orono is handling themselves pretty well, and,
yeah.
and this is with extended rest here for Meghan Mandel. And that can only be a benefit to Ellen Wiese as the season goes along, and drawing the foul is Jorgensen. It will go against Stewart. And we're going to have another, well, starter. It looks like Strigow's going to sub in. It's been a while since we've seen her. Danielle Jorgensen has committed to Cornell University in the Ivy League, and athletics and academics is something that a lot of people at Orono High School take seriously. It's a tough academic school, and I think that's very much evident when you have several players who are being considered by the Ivy League schools.
Yep.
And a lot of these players understand, as Jorgensen makes both free throws, that athletics will end at some point, and then you have to face the real world.
Yeah.
And there's another way the Orono team kind of grounds themselves, and I'll get to that soon. But they're a very charitable group. Here's Adria Stewart for three. A little strong, and Jorgensen with the rebound. She has numbers as Orono looks to build on the 11-point lead, and they can't quite do it. Loader came up strong there. Adria Stewart has a lane, and she'll shoot two.
Stewart only 5'2", Mike, but unbelievably quick.
Adria Stewart, the niece of Tony Stewart, the assistant athletic director at South High School. And Adria Stewart played on the Charity Warriors AAU program this past summer, so she got to play alongside Suzanne Gilreath and Andrea Adams. And she also helped out with a clinic that was held here back in August, and we'll show that at halftime. Taylor Hill, of course, makes a visit up here every year when the Mystics face the Lynx, and so to coincide with that, as Jorgensen misses the baseline, Jay, Tanisha Scott organized a youth clinic, and Adria Stewart and the rest of the South team took part in it. I had the chance to speak with her. It was the first time she'd ever been interviewed, and you can see her nervous shakiness in this interview, but we'll run that for you at halftime. That was a great short subject film I put together. I also had the chance to speak with Rob Jones, the father of Tyus and Trey, and there's a daughter who will make her presence known in Apple Valley in the years to come. She's a few years away from that, but I had a chance to speak with her. Emil Jihad, who was the coach that led South to a state title in 09, and of course Taylor Hill herself. Minneapolis South is in the bonus, and so Lemieux will shoot a 1-1. The foul is on Hannah Strigow, and that's her third personal, so that's something to keep an eye on as we get to the second half.
Well, a big chance now for the Tigers, Mike, to get this thing back into the single-digit range. You've got to convert on the free throws, and they didn't there.
But Left's got the O-board. Adria Stewart, oh, she traveled.
Wow. And that was a big call there, Mike, because she hit that three.
And a tough one, to say the least. I'm not saying I disagree with the call, but it was kind of a bang-bang play, and, well, it happens. Kayla Abraham, number 30, will come in the game for the Tigers, and Jade Hill is back in there. Traveling violation on Anna Hughes, number 5. And South, they got to get control, and they do. 1 minute and 20 seconds left in the first half. Stewart not giving up. Can't hit it there. Stewart has yet to make a three, and as you noted before, one was wiped away by a traveling violation. Lily McCown with the layup. Orono up by 12. South hole for the final shot. No. Pass mishandled. Jorgensen with a wide open lane to the basket. Goodbye. Daniel Jorgensen up to 11. Well, she's a facilitator, all right. She's facilitating herself. Spartans lead by 14 with 24 seconds to go. Stewart finally gets one to fall. She's up to six. Orono with plenty of time. And Jorgensen traveled. I don't want to say that was a makeup call, but that was very similar to the call that went against Stewart.
Yeah.
And, you know, again, it's a judgment thing, and sometimes you get a little bouncy. So South with 5 seconds to get a play off. Hill almost loses it. Fires the runner and will be short, and that will bring the first half to an end. Orono, they had a few mishaps, but overall, a very poised first half, and Danielle Jorgensen, a big reason for that with 11 points.
No, absolutely. She's really surprising me in a very good way with her experience and her play here in this first half, Mike. You know, I look at it from a South perspective, you know, coming down the stretch here in this first half, they really had some missed opportunities. We had the missed free throw down here that could have brought the thing back into single digits, and now they're trailing by 12 here in the break.
And also the three-pointer that was called off due to traveling. And just overall, South having some trouble hitting their threes, but we'll see what happens in the second half, and we'll get to the basketball clinic that was held here, that short documentary I produced, and then we'll have first half stats and analysis. You're watching High School Girls Basketball. Orono leads 38-26.
You know Taylor Hill, she's definitely about family and commitment and giving back.
It shows the love and the compassion and the loyalty to the program and to the school as well as the community.
When you give that vibe off to not only kids but adults, people gravitate to you, and she has it. Taylor, my family. So I do this because she's here, and I think it's a good thing that she's doing. Give back to where you came from, it's important, and I want to be a part of that.
I came from this community, so I think it's important that you come back and talk to the kids and show them how far you can really make it in life.
Taylor would always want to be the best player in terms of, you know, looking at her free throw percentage and how I can, you know, impact the team and get us a couple more wins. So she's all about trying to get better.
Hill is leading the state in scoring with 27.7 points a game and leads the team in free throw percentage. West ready for the trap or the help side, whatever it may be.
Hill gets out of the trap. She'll take it herself. And she gets it.
I saw her at some tournaments, and I could tell she was special. And then when she really hit the scene in seventh grade and started playing high school ball, she's just an incredible female athlete. I think she could play with just about any boy that I saw coming up in high school. She's just a competitor. She comes from a competitive family.
She was a guard, so she was a three-point shooter. I mean, slasher, driver. She was on her scouting report. Even at the U of M, she was on her scouting report, and we knew what she can do, and she's very good at what she does.
Hill, now she'll go inside, up the left side and in.
She was a great leader on the floor. She was like the floor commander, pretty much.
Reviewing game tape, getting here early, staying late, doing the additional work, getting in the pool, going down to the lake, running. After games, shooting countless free throws.
That just goes to show, like, you know what? I'm still working hard. She has great work ethic.
hard work obviously pays off, because look where she is now.
I just want to show the kids that no matter where you are in life, that you can make it. You know what I mean? You got to believe in yourself. You got to believe that you can do it.
Just with the amount of kids and the turnout with the parents that are still here, I mean, that's a huge compliment.
Some of these kids have that dream. Some of these little girls want to be like her. And when she comes around and says, this is where I play, this is where I practice, this is where I come from, and this is where you come from, it just goes to show them that they can do it. But it takes a lot of hard work.
She's a legend here in the state of Minnesota, especially for females, male or female. When I heard of the camp, I wanted my daughter to be a part of it.
It's always exciting to come back in here and get better and teach other people, because this is exactly where I was at when I was their age, working with Coach Emil and working on the same stuff that they are.
We want to make this side of Minnesota's feet don't touch. Point! Point! See how my feet don't never come here.
Some kids come in at all different levels. You're gonna have kids who can do the skill, and then you're gonna have kids that don't even know how to dribble. And that's okay. We show them the skill, you take that home with you, you can do what you want with it. But I'm showing you how to do a skill, practice it, then go on to another skill. It's a buildup and it's a progression. So I start very low, basic, just with form shooting. Well, today it was form shooting. And we work on to rip and go, catch and rip, one dribble pull-ups, three-pointers. I mean, that it's a buildup of things.
I was always told as a young coach, kids are like dry sponges. So they're gonna soak up everything, the good and the bad.
A bunch of good coaches coming together and having like such a big program like this is great. How we're talking to these kids and motivating them and getting them better, that's what we need to keep doing on the floor. Doing things like this can really help us on the floor as well, because it makes us better.
Hey!
I've seen other girl clinics and camps, and they appear to be girl clinics and girl camps, where this, I think some boys could be here and learn as well. They have really good drills here.
And it starts right here in these little camps. Even if it's just for an hour or two, that's how you get better.
I'm sure she went to her own camps growing up, but she's taking it to the next level and tweaked a lot of things and improved a lot of things as far as a youth camp should go and should be run. And I think these girls are fortunate that that Taylor has come back and put this on.
You get a lot of joy knowing that kids look up to you, and that, you know, they're happy to see you, they're happy to be here. I think it's a great feeling.
Being a city kid, there are so many vices that a kid could steer down the wrong path. And she's shown with hard work, you can accomplish a lot. You don't have to take the wrong path. You don't have to take the easy path. You can be successful.
And I've always said, and I've always maintained since she was in seventh grade, before I even had her as an athlete, that people like Taylor are just one in a trillion.
I do want to talk about to be successful in life, you gotta be able to do schoolwork too, okay? Like, I'm gonna be honest, okay? Parents, don't be mad. School wasn't my favorite thing to do, but I did it, you know what I mean? And when it came to schoolwork, my parents were strict about getting my work done. If I didn't do schoolwork, I didn't play basketball, and that's how it's gonna be. You don't do schoolwork, you're not gonna be able to play basketball. So school gotta come first, then hooping comes second.
Just on and off the floor, she's like a great like leader, I'd say. Kind of pulling the team together, like, you know, she's the glue of the team, pretty much.
The fact that you have a WNBA player in the gym with you, take it and really absorb what she's saying, listen to what she's saying.
You're gonna have to make sacrifices over your career. Some nights we didn't get to go out. Some nights we didn't get to hang out with our friends. Some nights we had to go straight home, practice, and go straight to sleep because we had games the next day.
They can see Taylor started where I am right now. That's what these little girls can see. She started right here where I am, and maybe one day I can be a Taylor.
You can't just play basketball. If you want to be the best, you can't just go to practice and just do practice and that's it. You got to do more. You got to spend extra time. If you want to be the best, you got to go to the gym at night. You got to go to the gym in the morning. You got to spend that extra time. You got to be able to outwork any and everybody to be the best.
Everyone wants to be around her. She just has that aura about her.
If you believe in yourself and start with yourself and you have that confidence, then nobody can really hold you back from what you want to do. It's great to have the support of a community and your parents and your friends, but it starts with yourself.
The skills that you learn here, take that to your basketball team and take that to your next camp or your school team and say, you know what? So what was so good about the Taylor Hill Clinic? I learned this, this, and this. It was fun. I got to hang with Taylor Hill for a little bit. I got to play one-on-one, three-on-three. I learned a little something, and just to take away that little sense of like, you know, I could be her one day.
Me being here today shows that you can make it out of any community. You know what I mean? You can make it from any situation as long as you work hard.
We welcome you back to Minneapolis South High School. That was a great experience being part of that clinic, and hopefully they will continue to host that in the coming years, even though a lot of the players involved at South have moved elsewhere. It's nice to see all the old faces come back, and that was my takeaway when I stepped foot inside that clinic. Orono leading Minneapolis South 38-26. Mike Peden here with Mr. Mayak, Alex Nagel. Daniel Jorgensen, your leader for the Spartans in the first half with 11 points. Rachel Rudd had 7. Meghan Mandel had 6. Those are your notables. And for Minneapolis South, Morgan Hill with 11 points. Jade Hill, who is averaging about 12 a game, has yet to score. Adria Stewart and Michaela Lemieux have 6. And I think just, again, the experience and just the tenacity and poise of Orono have made the difference so far.
Well, there's so many ways that Orono can hurt you, Mike. They can hurt you down low with Mandel or Rachel Rudd, or they can get you from the outside with Danielle Jorgensen and the other guards out there. And, you know, the other thing that impresses me with Orono so much, you pointed this out early on, that they not only have a lot of reserves, they have experienced reserves.
Again, Orono, the model of a long-term growing project. And you get schools that come and go throughout the years. It's difficult to stay consistent. There are a few teams who can do it. Hopkins is one of them. Maranatha Christian Academy in Class A. Well, pretty much most of the M's in that group. In 3A, Marshall and New Prague have been regulars in the tournament. 2A, Minnehaha. But there aren't too many of them. Lemieux was looking to go inside the Lutz, and instead throws it away, jump ball, and the arrow points to Orono. And so for a team like Orono, and then you see some teams like this, I don't want to say Minneapolis South was one of them because they had a lot of success in the Taylor Hill years. It's like, well, you made state, what are you going to do about it afterward?
Yeah.
And what they've established in the last several years, well, leaves them in a good position to be a regular participant in the state tournament for
yep.
Who knows how long.
Yep.
And winning breeds interest. We know that much.
Well, and you know, programs like this, like Orono, who become successful, you know, the young ones look up to these players right now and they say, I want to be like them. And they work hard and they get to that level.
Jump ball south of the arrow, and that's actually a good segue to one of the stories I was going to talk about with Orono. Each player is assigned to mentor a youth program, a youth club in the Orono area. And that's something that we see installed a few years ago just to add a sense of community to the staff. And it's been a great success. I'll talk more about it later in this half. Right now, South has the ball and having some trouble getting past this Orono defense. Adrian Stewart on the drive. Can't get the bounce. And the rebound goes to McCown. Jorgensen left alone. Bullseye. Jorgensen with 14.
In case anybody was wondering if there would be any drop off after Kiara Nelson, they just got their answer.
Jade Hill throws up a wild shot and it's picked up by Jorgensen. I'm not sure. I'm starting to wonder if I got fed some baloney with Jorgensen's offensive production. Well, she missed the three there. And a foul on Orono following the rebound. They're up by 15. And as I noted in the first half, you know, Jorgensen's going to have some games where she does step up just by design. Other games, she may only put up 5 points, and she's okay with that.
Yep.
The foul's on Tori Andrew. That's her third. She and Strigao now have 3 fouls, but right now that isn't too much of a concern for the Spartans, who are deep, very deep. Stewart, quick release. Still has not hit a triple. And as you remember in the first half, one was wiped away due to a traveling call. Strigao gets the fast break play.
Well, the Spartans stepping on the gas pedal hurt here early in the second half, Mike, opening up some distance.
They've scored the first 5 points of the second half. Traveling violation on Cushing. McCown. The elbow J from the left side is no good, and Morgan Hill has it. Morgan Hill, that's her strength, working in transition, and she'll shoot 2 free throws. As she draws the blocking foul, it will go against Tori Andrew. That's her 4th. Now, Andrew hasn't scored much, but that's going to mean Loder will take her place for a while. Now, Morgan Hill is a hard worker, and Nathan McGuire discovered that when you're working with Hill sisters, you learn that basketball is a year-round commitment for Morgan and the rest of her family. And that goes all the way up to Tanisha, you know, about PJ and, well, Taylor and Jade and pretty much any other child of Paula Monique. But she makes both free throws and, you know, Morgan Hill is coming along with this new system. Strigao missed the jumper, and we have Cushing with their first field goal.
Cushing making
first
up,
two, I should say.
Making up for that little traveling call here a little bit ago.
But Strigao can go in transition. Pulls up. Can't get her own miss. And Jade Hill with the board. Hill is blocked by Jorgensen. Jorgensen just about everywhere tonight for the Spartans. Cushing having trouble getting the inbound pass. And South turns it over.
The other thing about Jorgensen that is really impressing me tonight anyway, Mike, is that she looks like a true senior point guard out there. She's really leading the way, talking to her teammates, getting them involved, telling them what to do.
Strigao's missed a couple of those. And Adria Stewart deflects the pass. Lutz will be credited with the steal, but Stewart making the first move, and she draws the foul on 22. Madeline Loder, that will be her first, but free throws will be coming for Adria Stewart.
Well, South not getting away from their aggressiveness here, Mike. Down 13, a chance to pull closer here, but they've got to convert from the charity stripe.
Stewart gets the first one to fall. They give that last one to Rudd. So Rudd with her first personal foul. It would have been the first either way, and she subbed out.
Mandel, I was just going to say Mandel and Natalie Smerinchik, and now for the Spartans.
Minneapolis South, 6-10 from the free throw line. Orono hasn't gotten there too much, but they haven't needed to. Smarin, great feed, and Smarin is the beneficiary.
Well, Ellen Weesey decided to fortify that front line of the Spartans, and it paid off there.
Orono, much taller team, Cushing. That was blocked by Smarin. And Mandel will pick it up. Smarin, back-to-back buckets. Orono with their largest lead of the game at 16. Jade Hill struggling tonight, but has a lot of growing to do, and she does have a lot of upside. You know, the folks at South, Nathan McGuire, and even the athletic staff, Brett McNeil, all say, you know, Jade's going to be a kid to watch in the years to come.
Oh, absolutely.
No one is ready to tout her as the number one prospect just yet in her class. But Meghan Mandel takes Morgan Hill to the rim, and we'll get a three-point play chance.
She's just so tough to defend down there, Mike, when she gets in position.
And Mandel, I imagine, will be a great get for Marquette. And as Orono continues building this program of theirs, we're probably going to hear a lot of athletes doing big things in college in the years to come. Adria Stewart draws the foul on Loader, and that will be her first for sure this time. So Adria Stewart will run the point guard slot most of the season for the Tigers and helping keep the team organized. Struggling a little bit from the free throw line, though. As we've seen tonight, she likes to use the three-pointers, especially off flare screens. They've had trouble going in tonight, but she can also get to the hole. Now, this will be a good learning curve for South as Stewart splits again. Just learning how to, as South calls the timeout, attack the rim, get to the lane when you're facing a lengthy team like Orono, because South is going to face a lot of that as the season goes along.
Yep.
And to finish up that piece on Orono and their youth program, you know, they work with the elementary schools. It didn't take long for the Spartans to buy into that mentorship, and this team does a lot of service work. After practice tomorrow, they will take part in a holiday shopping drive, so they'll help get gifts for families in need, and that's always a great thing. So the Orono team, Ellen Weesey is very proud of what they do on the floor and how they've established themselves as student athletes, and with the success comes a higher profile, and the Orono Spartans have demonstrated that they can handle the higher level of exposure with brilliance.
Well, they're doing just that, Mike. Great players on the court and great citizens off the court as well.
And we'll see a few more great citizens on Tuesday in your neck of the woods. Actually, they'll be going up to Park Center for a few times this month. They've got some great games coming up as they look to try to make some noise in 4A. And well, we'll see if they can be the one to knock off Hopkins. I know, selfishly, fans weren't happy about classing up, but you know, that gives Hopkins another challenger.
Yep. You know, they actually played Hopkins pretty tough this last year, Mike, before falling late in that second half.
The two schools will meet later in December for a regular season meeting. I've got a feeling you'll be in attendance for that one.
More than likely. Unless, of course, it happens to be on the same day UCLA plays their bowl game.
Well, it's December 22nd, and I don't think UCLA will get that early of a bowl game. Usually that goes to the lower-level schools.
Yeah. Let's hope you're right.
Back to action here. South just trying to get some kind of momentum going. As we noted before, a brutal start to the season. Things will ease up a bit after this week.
Well, Mike, you know, as I mentioned from the top of our broadcast tonight,
Mandel with a swat.
And that was a swat.
But no, as I mentioned at the top of our broadcast, you know, sometimes it's good to get this kind of, you know, battle tested toughness here from the get-go. It will only help you as the season progresses.
And that's what Orono is doing. And in Orono's case, it benefits them to play the 4A schools because it doesn't really hurt them in section seating or in state seating if you happen to drop those games. But remember, this is an Orono team that went 30-2 last year. Michaela Lemieux can't hit the three-pointer. So they've proven very adept at handling schools no matter the class. Morgan Hill with a little stutter step, and she's pushed from behind. That's the one thing that I'm sure Weezy would like to clean up from this game is the discipline in the sense of fouling.
Yeah.
That's the fifth foul on Orono in this half, and that's really been the one hiccup tonight, and overall a very solid effort from the Spartans.
Yeah.
Jade Hill used up the dribble and got off her pivot foot. When I watch Jade Hill, and I kind of wonder to myself on you know what it was like for Morgan, who started on as an eighth grader on this team. Taylor did the same thing, and how those early games must have been. Jorgen, I should say, McCown missed the long deuce. Smarin can't get the putback. Jade, still looking for her first point. Wide open three is strong from Loader. Rudd is there, had a good first half, can't finish. Adrian Stewart has it. And Jorgensen with the tip.
Well, you know, Mike, talking about somebody like Jade Hill, for example, the seventh grader, as she gets older, she'll understand and master the nuances of the game. For instance, on that last turnover, I felt that she gave up her dribble a little too early. And she'll master those types of things as she gets older.
As Nathan McGuire told me, she was only in elementary school last year. And this is a big jump. And Jade was reluctant to come on the varsity team this early. I think she wanted to get some experience and grasp a few things at the lower levels. But they said, I think we're ready for it. And as you noted, this type of experience now, you know, in a few years, I think we're looking at 2021. Stewart with a quick release, but that was off the mark. That's really has hurt South tonight. If they make a few more three-pointers, this game would be considerably closer. But Jorgensen has been on point. Well, she's short there. And Jade Hill couldn't quite control it. Smarin falls on it, and Orono with the arrow. And there's another example of something that will probably be more polished as Jade Hill gets older.
Yeah. Good job by Smarin, though, corralling that ball. She was in a real awkward position.
Jorgensen is off. Stewart to Morgan, and Morgan can't hit the triple. Loaded with the rebound. There's Jorgensen. Out to Loader. Rudd. Oh, Jorgensen with a little fake there. Rudd just went on Lemieux's back.
Rudd at 5'11", such a versatile player, Mike. She can do the dirty work down low, as we just saw there. And she's also very dangerous from the perimeter as well.
She went on Lemieux's back and then recomposed herself in time to get the layup. Yeah. That was an impressive play for the Spartans. And Rudd, as we mentioned, going to Viterbo. Lily McCown, whose name we've called a few times, will go to Sioux Falls to play soccer as well. And then Orono very much playing to their number one ranking. And, of course, you know, they're not thinking about state just yet. They'll get there. But it, as we noted before, with state tournaments, it's interesting to see what those first-timers do and how they respond to it. Well, you know, understand that with Park Center, who won the last two 3A titles, and they had never been to state up until that point. Now Orono kind of taking that role.
Well, I think a big key for Orono, especially here in this early part of the season, is to not look too far ahead. They really just have to focus on what's in front of them.
Daniel Jorgensen doing just that, focused on the pass, and she draws the foul on Stewart. She'll shoot a pair. Jorgensen, as we noted before, praised for her defense, and Weasley thinks she could be the best defender in the state this year. And figures to be in the running for steals.
She really
goes along.
She really
as the season goes along.
I was just going to say, she really came out of nowhere to snare that steal.
Jorgensen with the back end has 15 points now. Orono up by 20, and from the looks of things, they will move to 2-0 with little difficulty. Morgan Hill with a spin move, runs into Rudd, jump ball south of the arrow. Rudd, once she found her position, she wasn't moving.
No.
She'll go out. Mandel Strigau will return, as does Tori Andrew. And I think this is overall a very telling performance out of Orono, where some of the big names maybe didn't play as much, and Orono didn't miss a beat.
Well, I think we're just getting a glimpse of how good Orono can really be this season, Mike.
Well, they can't get much better than their 30-2 mark a year ago. Lemieux, blocked by Mandel. That's her third, I believe. And Andrew with a quick release. And the quick deuce. She's up to 7. Not that I see this as a problem, but going forward, what tips or how will a team like Orono, who's probably going to be among the list of front runners in 3A this year, you know, how do they avoid succumbing to the pressure of, you know, having that ranking? I mean, they had some practice with it. They were the number one seed last year and have started this year the number one team. How do you make sure that doesn't get to you?
As far as just being up on top, having that target on your back?
Perhaps. Or even...
Well...
I see what Mandel was doing. She's padding her rebounding numbers.
Yeah.
Good cleanup by Meghan Mandel.
Well, I think the real key is simply not to focus on them, Mike. I mean... You know, when you're number one and you're going to be up as high as they are, you know, and presumably will be as this season progresses, you know, there's not a whole lot you can do about it. You just have to take care of your own business and focus on yourself.
Jorgensen with the transition deuce. You make it sound like Orono would rather not be number one.
Well, no, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying you just have to focus on yourself. You can't worry about the perceptions that others have of you.
Jade Hill finally gets on the board. That's good for 3.
I mean, it's one of the things that comes with being so highly regarded and touted is that, you know, every game that you play.
Oh, great entry feed to Megan Mandel.
I mean,
the assist to Abigail Paris.
You know, it's just that comes with the territory, Mike. You know, you have to recognize and understand that teams are going to be coming after you. You're no longer the hunter, you are the hunted.
Well, and I think Orono still sees themselves as hunters because they didn't get the big prize last year in 3A. As we noted before, state semifinalist, upset by Marshall, if you want to call it that. Weesey didn't feel that way only because Marshall had more experience.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's something Orono's going to have now. But, you know, coming that close, and who knows what would have happened had they played Park Center.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I don't think they're going to feel like they're being hunted because, you know, they're still hunting for that first title. The Muse three-pointer in and out. Foul before the shot. But you see Jorgensen not giving up. And Weesey's going to bring in some more subs, as will Nathan McGuire. And one of those subs is number 34, Cameron Benjamin. And there's really a lot to praise about this Orono team, what they've done tonight and just how they've conducted themselves. Yeah. I mean, they're a model school, and it's been great to see not just basketball, but so many of their other athletic programs become successful. And, you know, a team that I don't know how many folks were familiar with the town of Orono before recent times, but it's good to see this this type of success and commitment and initiative spread throughout the school.
Yep.
And Minneapolis South, well, they will learn a lot about themselves after these first four games. Morgan Hill has a chance for a three-point play. Morgan Hill at 25 in the win over Richfield, and McGuire didn't have much control over the schedule. Tanisha Scott was the one to put it together before she left the De La Salle job, yeah. And so, you know, you've got a new coach and you've got all these schools that you want to face.
Yeah.
But McGuire and the rest of the team kind of looked at it as, you know, the philosophical approach. We may not win all those games, but we're going to learn a lot about ourselves, and that could be useful later. Striga follows her own miss and banks it in. Adria Stewart released a little too soon. Oh, she and Jade Hill have had really tough games.
The South certainly not giving up, although down by 24.
Well, remember, these are all chances to learn. And Stewart misses the three-pointer. Because of the playoffs and every team, you know, making the playoffs in their sections, you want to use that time to get better. And, you know, as this team continues to adapt to McGuire's man-to-man system, you know, they could be more competitive. And they showed some signs of that as Strigow gets the layup there.
Yeah.
In the game with Richfield, they held them to 6 points in the first 13 minutes of that contest, won convincingly. And he had a lot of great things to say about his team. And Jade Hill, even though she struggled tonight, well, we've got Cushing with another three. That's off the mark. He said even if Jade was nervous about coming into varsity, he also said he's never seen a player as confident and ready as she is. And not even the likes of Carly Wagner and Rebecca Dolman. I don't think they were studs when they first started. And they were babies in the proverbial sense. Well, Morgan Hill drawing the foul on Strigow. And in the case of Morgan, as we've seen before, great in transition, can go coast to coast in a matter of seconds. The project, the goal for this year is to make Morgan Hill more of a vocal leader. And as I noted before, she was kind of shy last year and maybe not as talkative as some of her siblings are, but, you know, over the years she's gotten more comfortable with her surroundings. And
well, you know, and for a team like South that isn't senior laden, you know, I think at some point in the season, she's going to have to take on that role of being the vocal leader.
And that's going to take time because if had Tanisha Scott stuck around, I think that process would be a little easier. And if you're wondering, the two are still in contact with each other. They miss each other a lot. And
So we have a horn malfunction.
And the horn is apparently not pleased with my commentary tonight. The horn is offering its opinions.
And still is.
Was it something I said? What did I say to make it go off?
I don't know.
Well, buzz off.
Oh.
Morgan Hill makes both free throws. And that puts her total up to 18, and she's been averaging about that figure throughout the season.
If only Tony Gear were here for something like that.
Oh, Tony would probably have a few things to say about my recent escapades, the Lynx winning their third title, and all the other stuff I've been doing. Tori Andrew missing the long jumper there, but Orono works with the O board. And interesting that you see Orono, well, still playing like it's the first possession.
Nice job. Good layup by Loader, the sophomore, on that one. Ellen Weesey starts unloading her bench.
And I think it's time to do just that, as South had done the same thing. So Morgan Hill will finish the night with 18 points. The outcome that perhaps you expected, but what do you make out of Orono and what they could do as they continue along? Let's remember, their schedule has more 4A teams on the horizon.
Right.
Jade Hill with the N1.
Well, I mean, for me, we knew coming into this one, Mike, that Meghan Mandel was the primary focus of their offense. But I think what's stuck out to me even more was how good Danielle Jorgensen is and how good she can be. And there's been some other players who have stepped up tonight as well. I was impressed by Rachel Rudd, Natalie Smirn. She's performed awfully well tonight too, I think.
They say you can't coach height. I don't think you can coach depth either.
No.
And a three-pointer. That draws an emphatic reaction from the bench by number 45. She's not listed on the varsity roster. You might have that, though.
That would be Alyssa Dennison.
Alyssa Dennison, and it looks like Jade Hill scored that last basket.
I think so.
So Alyssa Dennison, consider yourself on the score sheet. So you'll appear on the internet and papers tomorrow. And it's always exciting to see the deep players get points, because you always see the reaction out of the bench. In the case of Orono, they always like it when the underdogs, quote unquote, can make a play. And we almost had an encore. Here's Cameron Benjamin. Oh, comes up short there. So Orono with a convincing win. They will move to 2-0 on the season. South will fall to 1-3. Big learning experience for both teams, but Orono's depth and talent very much evident. It'll be fun to see what they do later on. That would not have counted. Final score here, 69-45. Orono, a convincing performance from start to finish, and I think they have a lot to look forward to as we continue the season.
Well, I tell you what, I definitely want to catch this Orono team in action again this year, Mike. They're a fun team to watch, and the future, and I mean, just this season alone, it holds a lot of promise, that's for sure.
It does, and perhaps we'll see them at state again in March, but we've got a long way to go before we worry about that. We'll try to get a word with some of the Orono players before we wrap things up. This is high school girls basketball. Orono wins 69-45. And I'm here with Danielle Jorgensen and Meghan Mandel of the Orono Spartans. Danielle, we'll start with you. Coming into this game, your head coach mentioned that you were more of a facilitator than a scorer. Well, tonight you were facilitating yourself. Big performance. How did you find it?
I don't know. My teammates were making a lot of good plays, and we looked to run the ball a lot up the floor, and I just tried to score in transition and make easy buckets off of steals and stuff like that.
And coming into this season, maybe a lot of expectations, but also a lot of excitement. You got your first state tournament appearance last year and carried that momentum so far into this season. So what's the move been like, and what are you looking to accomplish?
Getting to state was a huge goal for us last year, and now we want to get to that state finals and try to win state this year. So we just have to keep setting the standards higher for us and getting better as each game goes on.
And the scheduling is very evident of that. This is the second of many 4A schools you'll be facing. So does, what are the challenges that come with that, and maybe what are some of the things you look forward to when you play a schedule as tough as yours is?
A couple of the challenges are when we play these bigger schools, we're going to have a lot closer games and maybe even playing down more. I know that was a problem for us last year because we hadn't been down the whole season, and then Marshall got up on us and we really didn't know how to handle it. So with these tighter games this year, we'll be able to handle that pressure so that when we get to state, it will be easier for us.
Wayzata was one such case of that. And then another thing on your side is depth. Just tell me, what do you make of this team and just how deep they are? And a lot of your bench players tonight, when your starters were in foul trouble, came up big, including Rachel Rudd.
Yeah, our bench is a huge part of our game. We work 5-on-5 every practice and get everyone into the rotation so that we can have that depth during the game, because sometimes stuff like that does happen and we just have to handle it. And the bench players came off. Rachel came off great, and so did Loader. It was really great.
I'd like to see that 5-on-5. Meghan, last year you were battling through some illnesses and so had to come in late, and now you're healthy. And so just what freedoms and what benefits does that give you as you play your senior season?
I mean, it just makes me more energized, more passionate to play. I just don't take my health for granted anymore, and I just play my heart out every game and try to do the best I can.
You did that tonight, getting several rebounds, 3 blocks. And so just tell me, what do you do to make yourself such a versatile and efficient post player?
You know, I try to set screens and move as much as I can, but it's really the passes from the point guards that gets me everything, for sure.
And then I asked this to Danielle, but getting to state last year, you know, that was exciting. And then some folks maybe would consider you the hunted, but in some ways you're also still hunters because you want to get that first state title. But just what does it mean to be part of this long-term building project and now to see it continue like this?
I mean, it means everything. We've been working so hard to get to this point, and now we're playing all these tough teams and getting better each game and every practice, and it's amazing.
Now, we talked about depth. Why don't you talk a little bit about camaraderie? Because I know you guys tomorrow, I think, will be doing a holiday shopping drive. You also work with youth to mentor them as they start out. What is the bond like with this team, and you know, how has this journey over the last few years helped strengthen your connection with each other?
The bond is unbelievable. I mean, we have team sleepovers, and we're just the best of friends, and it hopefully shows on the court. We just work well together. We know each other's strengths and weaknesses, and we try to play off of that. So.
Well, it certainly showed tonight. Finally, before we let you go, anyone you want to say hi to that might be watching this?
I don't know. Do you want to say hi to anyone?
I just want to say hi to my dad. Hi, Dean. And that's it.
And no one at Cornell, or?
I mean, hi, Val. Hi, Cornell.
You'll be heading there next year, and well, I'm sure she'll be saying hi to her Marquette teammates in case of Meghan in a few years, but congratulations. Perhaps we'll see you back at state. A long way to go, of course, but you're off to a good start at 2-0.
Yeah, I'm so excited.
Yeah, we're excited. Thank you so much.
That was Danielle Jorgensen and Meghan Mandel from the Orono Spartans. That wraps up our coverage from Minneapolis South tonight. For everyone on our crew, I'm Mike Peden. Thank you for watching.